that, we will start our panel. So if our panelists want to take a seat. This is basically going to be completely like open forum. If you have a question to ask, like that you've just been bugging you about getting into Ruby, or things that frustrate you about Ruby, or whatever comes to mind, as long as you're not asking like personal details, like someone's address or their phone number, that's perfectly fine. We also would like all of the questions that you have to be asked within under 30 seconds would be great, and it has to be a question. None of the rambling, like, I want to make a comment about X, Y, and Z. Please, like, if you want to have a comment or a conversation like that, there will be time afterward to have those conversations.
Take it to Twitter.
So Twitter will be a fantastic place to go. We have two people. Actually, one of you could move to the other side so that we get some... Awesome. So we have two people with mics. So if you have a question, just raise your hand. I'll point at you, and the mic will be delivered. And just talk into the mic, and that should be it. So without further ado, we'll have the panelists introduce themselves and give a little blurb about themselves. Anything else?
Since you're looking at me, I guess I'll start.
Yeah. No. You're right. You're closest to me. So, and we work together. So.
We do work together. She's awesome. Work with, by the way. My name's Brent Miller. I work here at New Relic. I've been doing Ruby for 10, 11 years or so. I'm self-taught as a programmer, so if you are in that boat, I know what you are going through. When I got into programming, things like Epicodus, that kind of code school, did not exist. It was not an option. Either you got a CS degree or you had nothing, so I had nothing. And it turns out you can have a great career doing that. I worked in academia, in industry, at Intel, and then here. And that's been my kind of career progression.
How long have you been working here? What's your position?
I've been here at New Relic for 6.5 years. I am now a principal engineer and architect. When I started, I was just a software engineer. I kind of knew Rails. It was pretty cool.
Hi, I'm Sam Livingston-Gray, and I also actually started out as a self-taught developer. I came into programming through Microsoft Access and Visual Basic. I did that for a couple of years, and then discovered that Microsoft Access is a very small job niche. So I went back and got my computer science degree, so I have some experience on sort of both sides of that. I've been doing Ruby. I think I first encountered Ruby in 2004 or 2005, and it looked really weird, and I didn't pursue it any further, but then I got back into it in 2006, and I've been doing Ruby more or less full-time ever since. I currently work at Real Geeks, which is a company that does real estate web services, and they're based in Hawaii, so office visits really suck.
Aren't you part of a certain podcast too now?
Oh, that's right, and I joined the Ruby Rogues podcast a couple months ago, and that's been really awesome.
Okay, can you hear me? So my name is Jesse Cooke. I started doing Ruby probably whenever the Rails 1.0 or 1.2 book came out, 2006, 2007, somewhere in there. I don't have a formal programming background. I kind of learned on the job. I did take some classes at PSU back in 2004, 2005, like certificate program. This was also like before all the code schools. And I co-founded a nonprofit in 2011. And so I have some kind of nonprofit experience. We did go through Y Combinator, so I have some kind of startup experience. His name is Watsi. And I've also been a consultant here and kind of throughout the country. And now I work at a company called Stericycle, specifically for a product called InQuicker, and we do online self-scheduling for patients. So I've kind of transitioned away from web stuff, and now I work on the integration between our system and the nastiest APIs ever, hopefully not dreamed of.
I also hear that you do a number of contributions to high-profile Ruby projects.
Oh yeah, I have made contributions to a number of Ruby implementations. One of them, Rubyist, one of my friends friends back there, Brian Shirai. We'll hopefully talk about that later this evening. Maglev also, which hasn't seen very much love over the last few years, and maybe like a patch or two to JRuby. So yeah, I've gotten around a little bit.
All right, so it looks like we have three people up here who don't have a traditional background, which I didn't know about before this. So that's kind of entertaining. So if you're looking to get into Ruby or into technology in general, this is a great group of people to ask. So we're opening up the floor now. If you have any questions that you want, if there's an awkward silence long enough, I will start filling it. In the back.
So one of the frustrations I have with Ruby, and Ruby was my second or third language, is how Ruby interacts with the memory space. And one of the reasons why I started learning Ruby PDX is particularly because I was frustrated with asking questions about how, why is this thing faster than the other thing? I want to know, like I really want to know. Are there any resources that you guys currently go to or commonly go to find out why specific syntax or specific ways of doing things works better or worse within the memory space?
That is an intense question. No, do not apologize. That is an amazing question.
So we just had this whispered conversation. My statement was, I got nothing. I mean, excellent question.
SF Eric on Twitter with a K, and he's posted some stuff, and I did some benchmarks. There's either a GitHub repo or a project. I feel like Schneems from Heroku has also written on some stuff. They've kind of looked at performance of different parts of Ruby. I mean, I think that, you know, what we've kind of seen happen is that Ruby has like the benchmark module, and you know, the original creator of Rubinius, Evan Phoenix, he wrote benchmark IPS, which takes kind of a different approach. But the thing that, in terms of performance, is you have to figure out what is actually important to you, and then kind of figure out how to test that and measure it, preferably in production. So,
there's new Relic is good.
There's new Relic.
It's gonna be really awkward.
And so you know, of course, there are tools that help you do that. New Relic, Skylight, some others. There's some stuff that's built into. I'm sure Brian will talk about this later, but there's some stuff that's built into Rubinius that's relatively new in terms of profiling and analyzing your code. So there's a lot more now than there used to be. That's for sure. But in terms of like actual things, kind of watching what happens to Rails is usually, like whenever they, you know, Rails is the code base that Ruby's kind of built on nowadays, if you know what I mean, like kind of the industry around Ruby is generally is Rails focused. And so whenever Rails introduces some type of performance improvement, you know, it's usually because a lot of people have seen that in production. That's kind of a good place to watch.
Awesome, thank you. If you could post any of that information later on, I would appreciate it.
I will try. It might, try just looking up like fast Ruby. Like,
yeah.
I think that's it, but I know Eric Michael Zober has done some work with that, so.
I'm mostly interested in fighting the idea that it's a black box.
We
should learn as much as we possibly can
about
how it works, because that makes us better developers.
I would like to add as well that I have personally seen Lauren give an excellent talk on using, was it RubyProf?
That's exactly what I was about to say.
Take it away, Lauren.
There are two tools. Perftools.rb is a tool that is for pre-Ruby 2.1, which I forget what his name is, but the GitHub repo is TMM1 is his username. But then he also created StackProf, which is another tool. And these are both profilers that allow you to dive into like what your Ruby is calling underneath everything. And I know that Aaron Patterson, when he's working on performance work for both Ruby and Rails, will actually use those tools to tweak performance improvements. So those are two tools that I personally use to get deep down into the code that I write if there's a performance issue. So.
There's always the other alternative, which is if you speak C, you can go read the C code in the MRI implementation if that's what you're hosting with. And in the end, like, it's, you know, it's turtles all the way down. Like, at some point, those beautiful, elegant Ruby phrases that you're writing in your editor have to get turned into machine code. And that translation into C in the Ruby implementation is where a lot of the performance happens. And because Ruby didn't start out as a language that was really intended to be used, it was written as an academic exercise. When Rails happened, the Ruby community had a big shakeup because they had to come to grips with the fact that people were running it in production. And performance mattered now. It wasn't just an exercise in what if everything is an object. Wouldn't that be cool? Well, it is really cool. And so we're still seeing some underlying implementation issues work through the Ruby core team as they're coming to terms with, like, yes, this is a thing that a lot of people are using in production, and there's businesses now that depend on us. So, you know, when Java first got released, it was stupid slow. It was terrible. The JVM now is this remarkably bulletproof, fast and stable technology. And we're seeing the same trajectory in Ruby. It's getting a lot better, it's getting a lot more stable, it's getting a lot faster. Come back another 5-10 years, it'll be amazing.
Thank you guys.
Yeah, next question. There we go.
Hi, I just have a question related to computer science degrees, since none of you have one.
I
have one.
Okay,
sorry.
But people pick them up afterwards, I think.
Okay, well, that's kind of what my question was about, is what do you think about getting a degree after you're already employed as a software developer? Have you ever considered that, or do you think it's worth the time and money that you could be spending just getting better at your job or maybe learning it on your own?
I think, like, you have to start that one since you're the only person who's done it.
Okay. part of why I went back was, as I mentioned, I found myself in a very small niche where it was difficult to find jobs. So part of the decision was literally I enrolled in classes at PCC and I kept applying for jobs and I said, well, whichever one happens first, that's what I'll do. But the reasons that I was considering it included things like, you know, I was searching for information about how to do something or what was the best way to implement something or why is this slow. And I kept running across a bunch of concepts that I just didn't understand, and I knew that there was a lot there and that it was going to take me a lot of study to figure them out. Things like regular expressions, I had no clue. And I knew that, I didn't know at the time that I have ADD, but I did know at the time that I learned best when somebody else was setting the pace, and so the classroom instruction worked really well for me. And I knew I wanted to be forced to, like, actually interact with some of this material that I would, if left to my own devices, just kind of go, "Eh, that's too hard. I'm not going to deal with it," because that's what I've been doing. As for whether a CS degree is required, certainly not. Is it valuable? Maybe. I got a lot out of it, and the things that I learned really inform everything that I do. Like, it's nice to know that I'm writing up at a high level, but to have that sense that I know what's going on underneath. And so I personally get a lot of value out of it. I'm not sure if that value translates well into a dollar amount that you're going to pay for tuition. What do you think?
So I thought about this. In my prior career, I was a botanist. And it turns out, like, hey, botany, they don't really know what computers are, necessarily, in that field. So there wasn't a lot of crossover in the applied sense. And so I considered it. I got out of the botany career because, like, there's no jobs there anymore. And turns out you don't need the CS degree to write code. After being in grad school for 5 years, another undergrad degree seemed like a really bad plan. And I found that what that decision has resulted in for me, the consequences are that there are some kinds of engineering I'm just never going to do. So I look around at, like, at New Relic, for example. We have this massive data intake pipeline, and a big chunk of that data lands in a distributed database that we built in-house. I will not work on that distributed database team. I don't have the skills for it. They, like, this is the one time when, you know, the difference between a normal B-tree and a red-black B-tree is, like, really important. That's 1% of the engineering jobs at our company. I'm okay with not having access to 100% of the jobs, and so for me, it's been a no-brainer to not go back and get the CS degree. There's plenty of options to develop as an engineer and grow and become much better and become, you know, senior and leader and principal and influential and all those things without having a CS. But along the way, you're going to have to pick up some of the concepts. So if you're, you know, like Sam was saying, if you really need an external kind of forcing function for better instruction outcomes, maybe not the degree, but at least some classes might be helpful for you. If you're more self-paced, like I tend to be, learn it as you need it, and then it'll be fine.
So a colleague of mine who has a PhD in philosophy, who's a very good programmer, just recently went back to get his master's in computer science, and I'm like jealous. Like a little jealous of him because I like learning, and I don't feel like I can do it to the extent I'd really want to without going back and taking, you know, having some classes or working towards some goal. I've always kind of been goal-based. So I think that in seeing kind of like job posts out there, in terms of it relating back to, you know, employment, it can depend on where you are in the country. Like here in Portland, you know, only one person I've met in my 10 plus years of being in the tech industry here has ever needed to go back to school because he could not get a job programming without it. And this was kind of a long time ago. This might have been back when you actually needed to have, it was a lot easier to get a job with a degree than without. You know, if there's something that interests you, you know, like I kind of look at anytime you go somewhere and you do something and kind of put yourself out there, like you're really just expanding your network. So you might go and you might have a really crappy experience and you might actually hate it, but you might meet somebody who you jive with and then you work on a project with, and that leads to something. And it leads to something really small but really fulfilling, or it leads to something really big and really fulfilling, and that's also really nice. So you know, in terms of career, not here at least, maybe in the Bay Area, maybe in other parts of the country, but in terms of like writing code, people just want you to write code that, you know, works, is relatively correct, or at least you can fix the bugs quickly, you know, like it's I think that's kind of more important in terms of like bringing.
I have one more thing to add to this. I actually took the traditional route and I got the CS degree first, but what was kind of entertaining about my journey was I went to community college first and took web development courses, HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and whatnot. And when I transferred to a four-year school, a four-year CS program, they ended up dropping a large number of my computer science courses because they felt that they weren't rigorous enough, or that they weren't like actually computer science type stuff. The stuff that I learned in the classes that they dropped were the things that got me my first job. So that can, like, if you are in web development and you are feeling fine doing that, chances are you will not hit anything that you need the CS degree for. There's a lot that you can learn that is kind of its own thing, like learning about like concepts like big O notations, learning like discrete mathematics structures, things like that. They're really helpful, but like not necessary. And you can pick them up over time, like people were saying. But it's really what you want to get out of your career.
I think one of the other things to consider is not just geographic location, but industry. It's like New Relic, we are in the software industry. Turns out there's as many software jobs not in the software industry as there are in the software industry. in the software industry, we know you can be self-taught. If you're working for a healthcare company, they may not have that understanding, and those jobs tend to say, like, must have the degree. So depending on what you're aiming for in your career, the degree may be more or less valuable. That's another thing to kind of throw into the mix when you're making that decision.
And I would just like to add that some of the best things that I got out of my computer science degree were actually required courses that were not computer science. Like, I got exposed to sociology and psychology and human development, and some of my best classes that I got the most out of were public speaking, which I expected to absolutely hate, and I was totally surprised by one of my writing classes that turned out to be all about rhetoric, and it really informs the way I code, so there may be hidden benefits in there as well.
I can second that the courses not CS related were major things that have shaped my life and my career.
Totally liberal arts major.
was that good?
Yeah.
Awesome. So, and another question. I had two really good ones.
Yeah, good.
Don't be shy.
So just continuing off this idea of self-study, Sam's returning to CS degree notwithstanding, you've all been successful in structuring your own self-study and continuing it throughout your careers. So I'm just wondering if you can maybe each share a particular approach to self-study that you think has made that a successful venture for you. Has it been blocking out a certain time of day, or setting weekly goals, or writing reflections, or blogging, or presenting what you learned to your cat? I mean, what's the sort of thing you keep coming back to that you attribute to your success as self-driven students of the craft of Ruby?
I'll let you know when I figure it out.
That's actually along the lines of my answer. Like, I was in grad school because I love learning. Like, I was an undergrad here at Reed. Yeah, people who love learning, right? And so for me, like, that's just a thing that I do. I'm always studying something. And right now it happens to not be anything computer related. But for a while, I was like, let's learn this computer thing. And that's when, it was right around when Rails was hitting 1.0. My first version of Rails was like 0.97 or something. I just always am working on some kind of learning project. And for me, I have no tricks. It's just like there's a problem and I want to understand it, so I make the time and I do it. What seems to work best for me is I have to have an interest in the problem. If I don't have an interest, it's not going to happen. And I can try all the tricks in the world and nothing works for me. I just have to have interest.
I'm motivated by money, and
that's okay.
And that's okay. When it comes to programming, like, if you know, over the last 5 years, especially, there's been a bunch of interesting new languages that come out that do something, take advantage of something, maybe revisit something from the past. You know. Bring to light some old thing that is now new again and makes our lives better. And so I tend to read about those. And it's like on vacation, I've read books about Haskell and OCaml. And I've maybe written like 10 lines of Haskell. It's like an amazing 10 lines of Haskell. Only 10 lines of Haskell. But it's like I read the book cover to cover on OCaml. Why? No idea. And for me, I don't ever really pick it up and start like typing on a keyboard unless I get paid. And so if I really want to learn something, knowing that about myself, I figure out how to get paid for it. And that's my motivator.
I have one more. Another thing, I'm apparently just a second, a fourth
month. Can I get you as close as you can join us?
No, I like the power that I feel from this.
It's really good.
Yeah.
Cut her mic.
It's, for me, any time that I have a side project concept, that's when I explore new things. I wanted to learn more about, like, programming as an exploratory practice once, and I had a side project that I was just like, okay, we're going to build something, build a web application, and try to put off actually hooking up any type of persistence for as long as possible. See what this does. And I learned a lot about different strategies there. I had another project concept there where I was like, I want to know more about JavaScript and just working with JavaScript directly. And so I, even though I could have made what I did in Ruby in a week, I sat there and I was just like, I'm going to learn JavaScript. I'm going to focus on like learning how to structure callbacks and like figure out what the help promises actually are. And really like wrestle with all of these concepts in my side projects. It really gets back to the needing some type of motivation. You need to be interested in the project. Whether it's something that your job is telling you that you need to learn, or it's something that just is intriguing to you, figuring out what interests you is that main goal. And so if you are money motivated, talk to people who are already part of the industry. Chuck.
When you start learning a topic, do you spend time outside of work, or do you also spend time at work learning? I've noticed a lot of juniors are afraid to spend time at work, so I just wanted to find out what your perspectives were.
It really depends on your work.
Yeah.
Some places are very friendly to that kind of exploratory, self-teaching time. Some places really aren't. And so my time here at New Relic, we tend to be very supportive of that. One of the teams I work with now recently decided all the engineers get a half day a week to just do that. Some of the other teams I've worked on, not so much. So it really depends on the particular context that you're in.
From 2005 to 2013, I was either full-time but billed by the minute when I worked at a consultancy, or I was a contractor who billed by the minute myself. And so I tended not to learn or, you know, take time at work because I was billing somebody. But in coming up with something that would work for the client, there might have been some research involved. And so I did get something out of that kind of research phase on any problem I happened to be working on. It just kind of depended on what it was. Once I went full time, it's been easier and things are kind of a bit more flexible, particularly at my current job where we don't have we're not like releases every 2 weeks, or, you know, every week or every 2 weeks, like Scrum, this, you know, like we're kind of chill. So it's easier. We have a Slack channel called Knowledge, and that's where like we all talk about stuff. That's fun.
Since becoming a parent, and my daughter just turned 8, but since then, I have found that I have a really hard stop before and after work. So the things that I have learned since then, I have learned on the job. One thing that was really helpful was when I was working at Living Social, they had an unlimited vacation policy that actually seemed to be an unlimited policy rather than a, we're going to tell you it's unlimited so you don't use as much. And I took good advantage of that to take some time to, you know, go and teach because I wanted to learn more about teaching and pedagogy. So that was a nice thing to have available that I took advantage of. But by and large, I haven't learned a lot in the last 8 years. At least I don't feel like I have.
If you're more junior in your career, this is a good thing to ask at interviews. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about learning on the job? Because some places don't want you to do it. You may not want to work there.
Yeah.
Some places are comfortable with it, like New Relic seems to be, but they don't actively encourage it. Some places are very actively encouraging. And that's one of those axes or dimensions you should consider when you're looking at a potential.
I would also say if you are interested in, like, if you enjoy it, pair programming with more senior people is one of the best ways that you are going to learn on the job. You're going to see them do things. And the main thing when you are pair programming with someone is do not be afraid to ask questions.
Yeah.
It's an amazing way to really just ramp up very quickly. One of the best experiences I had was actually working at Living Social as well, where I was paired, I being like a senior developer who just came on the team, was paired with a more junior developer who had been working at Living Social and at that job for a number of years. I think he had 2 years in the code base. And so he had all of the domain knowledge. I had like the senior understandings of Ruby and whatnot. And that was a great way to get both of us to be more productive. So if you have been at a job for a while and they hire a senior person, ask your boss if you can tag on to them and teach them about the code base while you learn about the language.
Yeah, and thank you for bringing that up because I absolutely adore pair programming. I would spend 75% of my day pair programming if I could. And as you know, if you're early in your career, I've noticed a lot of people are hesitant to ask for pair programming time, and you know, obviously it depends on who you're asking and the culture that you're in. But personally, I would absolutely love for somebody to ask me, "Hey, can I pair with you on this thing for a couple of days?" It gives me somebody to talk to because I work from home, and it helps me stay in a more beginner-oriented mindset, because I get into my own code for a while and I start slinging code that nobody else is going to understand.
I've worked with him.
I too have worked with him.
Understand what he wrote.
It's not good.
But I also love
teaching. Yeah, and so it seems like a lot of people who are on the other side of the desk, as it were, are hesitant to feel like you're wasting my time as a senior, and I assure you, you're absolutely not. It's worth it to me personally to help you learn, and in the long run, it's worth it to the company because I'm going to help you level up faster, and over a couple of months, we're both going to be more productive than we would be if we left you to your own devices. So.
I'm probably the only person out here. I don't particularly love pair programming. But every time I do it, I learn something. It doesn't matter if I'm working with somebody who's more junior or more senior than me. I always learn something. And so, especially if you're more junior, you're hesitant to ask. Like, don't hesitate to ask. It's good for the other person, too.
Also,
they may not know it, but it
also
is.
Also, I will point out just a general human nature thing. We have the ability to say no if we don't want to.
No.
We can set our own boundaries. So never be afraid to ask about that. Another question? Saw that hand first, and we'll get to you after.
Hi. So a lot of learning programming and doing programming is learning, but just coming from the perspective of more junior people getting into the field, eventually I have to decide to stop learning. And I'm kind of interested in, well, you need to decide at some point that you can get a job if you want, so you can stop just learning. And I'm really interested in this kind of problem because it's, you know, there's not clear metrics in this industry. There's not just this CS degree. There's not some web accreditation that people accept. You just kind of have to go for it at some point. So I don't think there's a clear answer to this, maybe, but I guess how did you guys decide you were ready, or maybe you didn't decide and something else happened?
I got fired. And I needed more money.
Don't we all?
I moved out here in early 2004, like $2,500 in the bank. Back then, you could rent whatever you wanted. However long you wanted, it was great. Now that gets you like a month.
In a closet.
In a closet, literally. And I needed to, I was kind of in this, you know, weird spot where I had like a little bit of web experience, and I had this client, this former employer slash client in St. Louis who gave me enough work to like get by. So I was doing this really big, I mean, it was basically like a webmaster. But I was a webmaster at an enterprise company where if I billed them 2 hours to upload a PDF, they like did not care. Because it would cost them 4 hours for me to only bill them 30 minutes or whatever, you know, and like figure shit out. So I kind of had this side thing that just kept me going enough while I did this, you know, year of classes. And then when that wrapped up, I just needed to find a job. And so I got kind of lucky in finding a very senior developer who was starting his own company, and I ended up working for him for close to 5 years, and had some really good experiences, and I learned a lot. But sometimes if it just gets to that, try to plan so that it doesn't just get to the point where like, oh shit, I need a job now. But you know, learning is like fast Ruby or you know SFA in this blog post. Like that's just something that my brain remembers, right? Like so, I learned it to an extent to where I can help somebody else, and it's valuable. It's not necessarily valuable for me to have that information. I might never use it. I can pass that on to somebody else. And so you can kind of still learn. Things can still go in your head, and you don't have to fully understand them. You can just let them bake in there, and then maybe at some other point it'll kind of come out and be helpful. You need a job, get a job somewhere, somehow, doing something. And hopefully that will help you get to the point where you want to be. You know? It seems like there are a bunch of jobs out there. I think unfortunately now, given the number of junior developers I've spoken to, a lot of people are hiring from the senior level. And so, you know, what we've been kind of preaching over the last few years, especially here, is trying to get companies to understand that they need to invest in, you know, junior programmers, and it's okay that they don't know something, because right now they're not that expensive, but if you teach them, it will be a valuable investment to your company. So there should always be an opportunity to learn.
And if the question is, what's the cutover point where you decide you've learned enough and you want to go like try and find work, it's kind of like being qualified to give advice. The qualification is that somebody asked you. And I take sort of a similar approach to being qualified to program. The qualification is that you can help somebody and they will give you money for it. It may not be very much money. Like my first job, I mentioned getting fired from a sysadmin job. As it turns out, I was a terrible system administrator. I went home that day from being fired and I picked up a book on access because my dad had been asking me for help with an access project. And that turned into me learning to do rudimentary programming. And I also got lucky in that my dad was willing to pay me to learn this stuff as I went along. So that was my first programming job. My second programming job was a temp job. My title was office assistant. And I was helping somebody in a large bank send out documents. And while I was doing it the way that this person had done it, I would do that work, and then I would finish with that, and then I would try to figure out how I could write an Access database application to do the work faster and better. So I had the spare time in that job to be able to take a clerical temp job for, as I recall, like 12 or 13 bucks an hour, and turn it into a programming project that I used to get my third job, which was in the Bay Area during the first dot-com boom when everybody could get a job doing basically nothing. So I got lucky at least three times there. What's that?
Because you got a free chair out of it at the end.
Sadly, yeah.
Brent, anything?
My story is a little bit interesting in this regard. So the fall of 2005, I was in my PhD program. I passed my orals, which meant my board decided I was ready to advance to candidacy and actually do the PhD research, do the experiments that were going to turn to the dissertation. And then we went, my wife and I went to Australia. She's Australian. And we were driving across Australia, and there's this chunk in the middle of Australia called the Nullarbor Plain, meaning no trees. It's terrible Latin because there's actually trees there. And there's nothing to do. There's no civilization. It's a two-day drive. You can't drive at night because the kangaroos will destroy your car. So you have 8 hours of driving ahead of you, 10 hours of driving, and that's what you can do. And they have the longest straight stretch of unpaved road in the world. It's about 100 miles. So if the alignment on your car is good, there's literally nothing to do. Like, you put it in cruise control, and you're driving, like, looking around, right? So you think about stuff on this drive. And I was thinking about what my future was going to be like in academia, and I realized, you know what, this job, this career track wasn't going to get me where I wanted to go. The job I wanted as a botanist didn't exist anymore. And I was looking at, you know, 10 years of being a journeyman, we call them postdocs, moving from place to place, living in like Ames, Iowa, which I had no interest in living in. And so I decided in the car, I'm done with academia. And if I turned to my wife and told her, and if she had been driving, we would have driven off the road. And then we had a lot of time to put together a plan. And I was committed for TA commitments at the university, and so I had kind of another two quarters of work lined up. So I was like, okay, I can fall back on my tech skills. I went to computer camp when I was 10 and I got programming basic. I'm sure I can figure this out, right? And so I started working on it, and that's when I discovered Ruby, because it was just getting some press in the web business, because Ruby on Rails is hitting 1.0, and that blog demo was around. And so I started teaching myself, like, okay, I can do this. Like, I built a blog, I built more stuff, and I found everybody I knew who needed a website, maybe, and made one. And then, you know, how did I know I was ready to get a job? Well, I wasn't, but I did anyway. And looking back, I realized there was a lot of imposter syndrome going on. I actually was ready, I think. But it's really hard for you to know that because you don't have the experience in the industry to see it in yourself. And so you're really prone to that imposter syndrome problem. And so seek advice. Look at other people around you. This room is full of people who have experience in this industry, some more than you, some less than you, but everybody can look at what you're doing and say, feels to me like you're about there. And that, to me, is probably the best way to calibrate. I didn't have that. I was on my own. All of my friends were biologists. Most of them were marine biologists, the worst kind. And so I had nobody I could lean on. But how I was able to judge myself was I was looking at my output. And I was like, you know what? My friend needed a site. I put together a site. It works. It looks okay. I can do markup. And so my first job was doing markup at Intel. Don't ever take that job. It's a terrible job.
Take it if you have to.
Take it if you have to. I hope you never have to. There's some amount of like portfolio building that you can do as a developer when you're starting out. Like, I can put together a program that does this. And as you work on it, you realize that this becomes more complex. And so that's a way to track your progress. But really, like, get help from other people. They will see it in a way that you don't, because they have context external to you that's impossible for us to get by ourselves.
I was gonna say, networking. You're in a room full of people that are in the community, so talk to people. You're going to most easily find a job through the people you know. And number two, open source work. It's a pain in the ass that like you need to do extra work after your job that you're drudging through that you want to leave. But if you can get involved in an open source project, they will also start vetting for you. They become your community. And you also start developing code. If you can solve or help an open source community like triage issues and things like that, you have a skill that can get you into tech.
I feel like I have to put an asterisk, at least on the advice that I've given, which is that I am, by almost every metric, I think I'm over 40, but otherwise, I
didn't turn off his cell phone.
No, that's my alarm. I put my daughter to bed.
That's okay, Ben.
Can we FaceTime that right now?
No. But what I was going to say is, by every metric except for being over 40, I sit at the center of the dominant group in tech. And so the advice that I give you is kind of like, here are the lottery numbers that worked for me. Some of the things that worked for me will not work for you, and I don't know what they are. But I'm happy to help you try to think laterally around them if you want to talk to me about it.
I think that raises a really interesting point. I work a lot with junior folks here at Relic, and I get asked a lot about how to build a career. And I firmly believe that careers are not planned. They're built, which means every step is a new step that you frequently didn't see it coming. I had no idea I was going to end up in tech. And then when I got the job, I had no idea it was going to be at Intel. And then I got a job at my old college writing code that made them $3 million a year selling dorm rooms to students, right? Like, who knew that was going to happen? And then that got me this job here. And I don't know what's coming next. I have no idea where I want to go. It doesn't really matter, right? At some point, opportunity will present itself. You have to make them happen a lot of times, but the opportunities do show up. And then take it from there.
Was that a comment or a question?
Yeah.
I have a comment about it. Being someone
even though I do have a loud voice. As a woman who's been in tech for 20 years, the advice that I'm hearing works incredibly well for someone who is in the dominant paradigm in tech. However, if you are a woman or a person of color, the advice that I would give you is vastly different from the advice that I'm hearing tonight. Primarily because most of these jobs, it doesn't matter whether you have a degree or what you're doing, but most of these jobs come to you because somebody invited you in. This isn't something that happens as much for women and people of color. It's starting to happen with women in general, but definitely not yet for people of color. And the best way to get invited in, if you are not in the dominant paradigm, is to network, is to find somebody who wants you there, who actively wants you there, is to not apply through the standard route, but to go to companies and meet people and become known for being a decent human being and being somebody they want to work with, and then work your way in. And that has been more successful to me as a woman in tech in the last 23 years than any other method of getting in at all.
For the record, I think that's true for everybody, but doubly so for people who are straight white dudes.
As a trans woman in tech, that's why I brought up the networking. You need to develop a personal connection with people in the industry. It's one of the easiest ways to get in. And sometimes that's through open source. Sometimes it's through showing up at meetings, but you need to get involved with other people so that when that junior position comes up, they think, oh man, I know someone.
We did an episode of the Ruby Rogues recently called Networking Without Networking, where Carrie Miller came on the show and we talked about a lot of strategies for networking in a way that isn't like going to some horrible schmoozy thing and handing out business cards to people who are also looking.
It sounds like hell.
Yeah, it really does.
Paul, you have a comment? We should probably wrap this question up soonish.
So I agree with everything that's been said so far. One of the things that I did personally in my career, every time that I've tried to do a career transition, I've been primarily in programming, but one of the things that I think is really valuable both personally and to the community at large is if you're looking for a place to kind of test your mettle, go volunteer at a nonprofit. They always need tech. They are so underserved. They can never afford it. They always get crap. So go volunteer at a nonprofit. I guarantee they have a problem that needs to be solved. It is a legitimate problem. If you can solve it, you can go get a job. They need the work. You need the experience. It is a match made. And it is sad that it's not actually like a thing that we do on a regular basis. I've seen a couple of talks that have talked about this, but it should be like a standard. Like if you're learning a new thing, go find a nonprofit and hey, I'll do you a thing. They would love it.
It's amazing how happy you can make somebody at a nonprofit using 10-year-old technology.
Oh my god.
Any technology.
So, anyways, we should probably move on. You had a question back there, so right there.
Okay, yeah, kind of building off of that, I guess maybe one thing going to your first interview that you kind of, looking back, wished you did more in like the last month or two while you were learning or self-teaching yourself, and also if there's any good nonprofits, open source in Ruby that you would recommend for a beginner to maybe volunteer or get involved with.
Oh man, so I have a comment that I'd like to lead off with this. The first thing that I would say that I wish that I had done in my first interview is not list a goddamn number for my salary.
Yes.
Holy crap. I went into that completely blind. Like I said, you have a network of people here. Talk to other people. Find out how much your skills are worth. And if possible, don't mention a number ever in the entire negotiation. Let the company actually tell you how much they're willing to pay. Because I have seen companies where they'll try to undersell new, particularly junior people, by saying, oh, we're gonna offer you $40,000 a year. Well, if you're coming off of making $28,000, it's like, holy crap, $40,000 a year is amazing. A junior developer in Portland is worth, at the very minimum, $60,000 a year.
At the minimum, caveat, that depends again on the industry.
Yes.
So in academia, if you're making $60,000 as a developer, you're doing great.
Yes.
I was getting paid $50,000 and I was above the pay grade because I was on a grant funded position and they were able to bend the rules for me. My colleagues who had 10 plus years more experience than me were making 40. And now they're probably making 43. So again, it depends on the industry that you're in. Industry trumps everything.
That is true.
In the software industry, yeah, totally right. Like at least 60, if not more.
And to what Lauren said, we did another episode of the Ruby Rogues. I missed recording this, so I'm not actually plugging my own stuff here. But episode 274, called Fearless Salary Negotiation with Josh Duty. I just listened to it over the weekend. It's got a bunch of really good hacks for staying with the plan of not giving the number first.
So back to your question. The one thing that I wish I had done better my first interview was actually not a thing in the interview. It's I should have done more to inform myself about the company before I walked in. And that's a thing I didn't do in my second tech job because I had already worked with them, because it was the college. And I didn't do it very well with this job either. And it worked out great for me. Like, I got lucky, but it is luck. And there's a lot of stuff that you want to find out about the company before you walk in the door, and a lot more stuff you want to find out before you accept an offer. In particular with startups and young startups, you need to know that they have a business model that works. If the business model is, we'll get eyeballs and figure out the money later, don't go there. That job is not going to be around.
Or don't plan on staying there for very long.
Sometimes you got to take the job, right? That's totally it. And so there's a lot of that kind of like information about the company that you want to know about that I've been terrible at in my career. So don't make those mistakes.
I failed at an interview last year like pretty spectacularly. And so my advice would be know what kind of interview you're walking into. I walked into a very technical interview and I was not prepared for it. They were asking all sorts of stuff that I didn't even think like that. I was like, oh, you want to hire me for this, and that stuff I have experience with, I'm very comfortable with this, and then they asked me about that, and I was like, why would you ask me about that? You're going to hire me to do that. We didn't talk about that in the first interview. So yeah, just know what kind of interview you're walking into. Like, straight up ask them, be like, is this an informational interview? Is this a social interview? Is this a technical interview? If this is a technical interview, what kind of technical interview do you want? Are you going to ask me to, you know,
whiteboard?
Yeah, are you going to ask me to whiteboard? Because I don't actually whiteboard very well. Like, I don't handle that kind of pressure, but if you want to give me something that I can take home and do, you know, I'd be happy to present you with something. So yeah, find out, like, what you're going to be walking into so that you're prepared for that.
That goes back to using your network. If you are applying where somebody you know works, ask them, drilled them about it, just to ask like what type of questions they were asking, get as much information as you possibly can out of people.
I mean, and I would say whoever you're emailing about the job, like whoever you're going to meet, ask them. Mm-hmm. And if for some reason like they don't tell you, just decline them. Just, I mean, unless you like really need the job, like they're probably not people you want to work with. You know, they should. Anybody that's hiring is hiring because there's like they have there. You know, there's scarcity. Like they need to fill. They need to get somebody in there. And so if they want to talk to you, it's because they see something in you. And so you know, employment is like a mutually beneficial relationship, and they need to. They should help you be successful in the interview. If you walk in and they just start like slamming you, just table flip them off. We will all applaud you for it. You'll be like a legend.
I've done that once. I wish I had done it more. That said, sometimes you need the job.
Sometimes you need the job.
And so I'm going to flip it around and answer a different question than was asked. But try to pay attention to red flags, warning signs. Take a couple of days if you can to think about those things and let your initial excitement wear off. If you absolutely have to take the job, and I have taken those jobs more than once, always be in job hunting mode looking for the next thing. Because I've had good jobs go sour. I've had bad jobs that I just had to take because there wasn't anything else. But always having, looking ahead to the next thing gives you just more options and it helps you maybe feel a little bit better about doing the shit job you have to do right now.
Also, there's a single question that I always love asking people when they open it up for random questions, and it is, what is your least favorite part about this job? That answer, not even the answer, but the reaction after they hear that question will tell you multitudes about what you're about to get into. Time for probably one more question, then we should probably move on to other things. So, yeah.
If you follow the blogs and Twitter and the topics at conferences, you might believe that Ruby is dead. What are your thoughts on this?
Bullshit.
The table's really heavy.
I also hear that Ruby doesn't scale, which is a lie.
And TDD is dead.
Which is a lie.
TDD is dead, long live TDD.
There's this habit in our industry to always chase the brand new thing, and if it's more than 6 months old, it's old and dead. Well, so at my last job at RV, there was a guy who'd been there for a long time, and he was still running COBOL code that he'd written in the 70s.
I've heard of that guy. This code.
An urban legend.
And he was a nice guy. He was still there and he was maintaining it. And he was getting ready to retire, so they knew, like, oh, every time changes that code come up, let's rewrite it with something else that somebody speaks. But it turns out that the old code works. And there's a lot of value in that. And so in some industries in particular, you see this, like financial industries are really, really don't like changing stuff. Because those banking transaction systems, they've worked out all the bugs by now. The thing's been in production for 35 years. They know that it runs perfectly. No touching. And
sometimes
so,
to the extent that you have to write a virtual machine to emulate the hardware they can no longer buy.
Oh, yeah. Oh, there's amazing systems here. The airline industry also is full of this stuff. And it turns out those old systems, like, they still work, and they work great. And
the Delta issue.
That was a modern data center issue. That was not the old relation stuff. And so there's actually a lot of value in those old systems, and a lot of this, like, oh, Ruby is dead, that's hype and rhetoric that is not driven by financial realities. And the people who are saying that, look at who is that. Who is saying that Ruby is dead in public? Is it Gawker? You know? Is it TechCrunch? Yeah, I'm sure they're saying Ruby is dead because they need a story today, and it's a slow day in the valley. There's also a lot of people get up and say, Ruby is dead, Elixir is the hot thing, because they are on the Elixir team. And I'm using Elixir as a random example. I have no idea if they're actually doing it or if they're bad people or good people or anything. It was just the first word that came to mind. And so there's a lot of this kind of hype in the industry because we have the story for our news cycle and it needs to be filled. Twitter doesn't work well when you're saying, I'm having a very pleasant day. Nobody cares if you're having a pleasant day. Twitter, they want to hear, I'm having an awesome day, or I'm having a terrible day. And those extremes are what sell, and that drives this rhetoric. So don't believe any of it.
For me, the metric is, can I get a job today? Will I be able to get a job in a year? Will I be able to get a job in 5 years? And from what I can tell, Ruby is doing fine on all three of those metrics. That said, my own personal bias is that I have spent a lot of time cleaning up legacy Rails code bases. So I lag behind the bleeding edge by quite a bit. But there's a great career to be had in that because Rails lets you make big messes fast.
If anybody likes Rails 3.2, we're hiring.
No, it's not dying. But yes, you should go explore other things because it will inform your Ruby code. And you can go play with Elixir or play with Go or play with Rust, and you will, you know, expanding your mind is a good thing. We've kind of all done that in one way, shape, or form, and you should kind of do that with Ruby too. I still, you know, having programmed Ruby for like 10-ish years, I still really enjoy it. There's like this, it was engineered to be something that made me happy, right? All kind of that story, like it flows. It's easy to make a very native sounding code base in terms of like, well, I have thoughts in my head and now I want to express these in something that will run on a machine, and it like works pretty nicely. Like, does it have its warts? Yes. Then look at JavaScript. Like, JavaScript has its warts. Everybody loves it, and it's seen quite an uptick, and that's fine. Java has its warts, right? Like, people will complain about Go, people will complain about Elixir, will complain about everything. But if you have an interest in it, like, check it out, play with it. And if you come back to Ruby, great. Your code may be better and more informed because of it.
I think part of what's behind the Ruby is dead story, too, is that all technologies go through a life cycle. 10 years ago, I went to Ruby to RailsConf 2007, and their logo was literally a thing going hockey stick up and to the right, and that's where Ruby and Rails were at the time. And now, like even about 4 or 5 years ago, there was this thing I like to call the Cambrian explosion in Ruby, where like everybody was writing a testing framework, and then everybody was writing their own like Sinatra DSL for doing web apps, and that was really cool. And people were experimenting and figuring out what worked, and a lot of people were figuring out what didn't work. And now Ruby has sort of settled down a bit. And a lot of that Cambrian explosion action is happening over in JavaScript. And so maybe that's why people are saying that Ruby is dead, is because they don't see that vibrant activity. There's also, you know, there's a lot of creation and destruction and chaos going on there. And
left pad.
Ruby's
left pad, yeah.
Left pad. And Ruby doesn't have as much of that anymore. But it's still a perfectly good career choice.
It's okay that Ruby is mature and stable. That's a good thing, because when you write applications and people give you, you know, businesses rely on those applications, like you want something that's mature and stable. And it's kind of nice that Ruby's actually there. Because I remember like a very distinct conversation I had with my first employer. We were a .NET consultancy, and so this was like .NET 1.2 to 2.0, so things were kind of changing a lot there. And you know, there were a bunch of VB.NET apps, but we were writing in C Sharp, and that was like a relatively new thing. And I remember like driving in the car on the way to a client, I still see their signs around town, and I was pitching Rails, because I was like, well, Rails is this new thing, and it seems like we can move very fast, and it seems like the things that we're going to want to do on the web can be done quickly and easily and better in Rails. And of course back then, like, Rails didn't scale and Rails wasn't fast enough and all this stuff. And there was no science behind it. It's not like he built a like application in the two things and then, you know, made observations. And since then, now everything's built in Ruby and in Rails, and like barely anything's built in .NET, at least in kind of like our
that industry, yes.
Yeah.
And that is what we'd like to refer to as confirmation bias.
Don't blame me with your logic.
So yeah, it's fine. It's good. It makes your life easier.
It's it, it, it's not going anywhere. Like Sam was saying, there's going to be code that needs to be maintained for a very long time, and it is worthwhile to go and find out the new and interesting things. But if you're looking for a job, there's still going to be jobs here for a very long time.
One of the interesting things you can look at is, as part of this kind of life cycle, you've had this explosion of Ruby, and in particular, or centered around Rails. All these businesses are using Rails apps. How long are those code bases going to last? More than a year or two. Software tends to last 5 to 10 years, if not longer. Right, like CV, or CF, the COBOL, that was still production 40 years later. I can't imagine why 40 years later nothing has changed. Like, the logic that we needed is still the same logic. But so those apps that are being built today need maintenance for at least another decade. So even if Rails really was dead, which it's not, and no new applications are being written, we still have another decade of job in front of us.
I also want to unpack one other thing in that meme that Ruby is dead, which is that I think there's a tendency, as I think you mentioned, to sort of chase the shiny, and that sort of aspect of polyglot culture is something that worries me a little bit. As I worry about somebody who starts a new tech stack every 6 months. I would like to see somebody, if I'm on the hiring side of the table, I would like to see somebody who has dabbled in several things and knows one thing well enough to think in it. So that's just the caution I would give you.
And one last thing is that there is innovation happening in Ruby. You know, Rails was kind of it was like a new thing. The pattern wasn't particularly new, but the way with which it entered the market was new. So after Rails, there were Rails clones. After Sinatra, there were Sinatra clones. You know, RSpec was one of probably the earliest well-known kind of BDD testing frameworks out there, and that has informed a lot of other projects. So. That's then. There's still new things happening. You know, we see stuff in Rubinius, we see stuff in JVM, like MRI/CRuby. Like they are still working on making Ruby a better language. And so there is innovation going on. And you know, if anything, it's one of the easiest places to explore and to practice and to make new things and to try new things.
Apparently, at Ruby Kaiji, Matt's is going to give a talk about static typing in Ruby for Ruby 3. So Ruby's definitely not dead. That's going to cause a whole firestorm of things.
Yeah, my take on that is it's never going to happen.
We'll see what happens.
Something to play with.
Matt's have a habit of making things happen.
Yeah.
We talked about this on the Ruby Road recently too.
I think that was a great place to leave it. Just like. A comment or?
Well, actually, there was a question about which open source projects that I don't think you got around to. That would be good for people to get started on.
Yeah, I don't contribute to open source.
I barely do. I have one commit to Rails, though. If you're going to be a Rails developer, working on Rails itself is tremendously valuable. The community is very welcoming. They make it really easy to get started. But as you do that, you dive into the Rails internals, you learn how the system works, and you see all the magic. Rails is full of
sausage.
Magic. Let's be honest. Rails is full of magic. A lot of it is magical sausage, but not all of it. Some of it is just like really elegant magic.
Right?
It's
true. Yeah.
But by learning how that stuff works, it really makes you a better Rails developer. A lot of my most frustrating and most best spent times growing up as a Rails developer were trying to debug problems by reading Rails source code. And working on Rails, you get the learning without the frustration of like, oh my god, how do I fix this bug? I'm on the clock right now. And so that's actually a great place to start. Start with gems that you use, places that are going to be meaningful to you and your work. That's a great place to start in open source. Things that are interesting.
And then, you know, being Portland, Caligator, Caligator has code sprints. So if you're like completely new to open source, I don't know where to start. I think one of the easiest transitions in is to find like a welcoming community that will help you. Like I just saw something today where somebody was like, I did this thing, and then the creator of the language was like, that's awesome, can you issue a pull request? And the guy's like, I have no idea what you're talking about. I just did this thing. I don't know how to like issue a pull request. I don't know, like he wasn't familiar with Git, but he, you know, or GitHub, and so this, that, and the other thing. But there was kindness there, so kind of look for the kindness. But you know, Calligator's a great one because there's a ton of stuff. And it's local, so if you want
to meet up, find things for you to work on.
Yeah, like if you want to, you know, meet up with people, and that Calligator isn't the only one; it's just the one that you know we kind of use the most. So that's a great one.
I think it's also worth mentioning that on any project, like you were saying, finding the welcoming thing. Most projects will have some type of chat-based community or whatnot. Go into there, ask questions. See what kind of responses you get. If they are welcoming, and if they are like, "Hey, we've got this really great thing that we can that I'd love to work on with you," you know, do some pair programming. Like, get involved in the communities however you can. Slack is super friendly. IRC, if you don't know it, is less so. But they're often the best places to really kind of get a pulse of the project.
Exorcism also has a really good reputation for being beginner friendly.
Paul, you have
to? This is where we're a little light on open source project recommendations. There was a great talk that was given by, I don't remember his name, but he's the main contributor on Bundler.
And Andre Arco.
Yeah, they're a great project apparently. He gave an entire talk just about being friendly and documentation. They are. So obviously, if you're doing Rails development, you should know what Bundler. Hopefully, you know what Bundler is. It's a fairly large thing that a lot of people use. So contributing to Bundler would be a good thing to say, "Hey, I've done something here, and you might have heard of this."
Andre is a huge sweetheart and a personal friend of mine. So definitely recommend that. And we had a comment over there with Bernard, and then we'll end.
Pointing at me.
Oh.
Oh, you want to?
Yeah.
Oh,
okay.
I'll go first.
Yep.
I get to really like dive into it, but there's if you're a woman, there's open source for women or OS4W, and it's run by Caroline Ada,
Coraline Ada MP. Yes.
Who's also Ruby Rogues, and it lists all the places that are friendly for women and for beginners. So that's a resource.
Next month, or possibly the month after, the junior developer meetup here in town is going to be doing a my first pull request night. There will
awesome.
Be mentors and tables set up and like issues picked out to show up and go through the process of making your first open source contribution.
I personally want more information.
Yeah.
So
I will dig up the details and share it.
Please put it in the Slack or the mailing list.
Yeah. Any other questions? Chuck, back in the back. Walking away from your post, Paul, what the hell?
I'll be really quick. I just wanted to say, as someone who tries to get volunteers, I can tell you that every single one of those open source projects wants help desperately.
Oh my God,
yeah,
they do.
And even more, if they don't reply, that often means that they need more help.
Absolutely. Like I was actually gonna amend my statement of Andre. Andre is an absolute sweetheart. Sometimes he does not respond because he is swamped. So I think that's it for the panel. This was personally pretty awesome. And give it up for panelists.